I'd like to introduce Dr. Fabio Fenton. In 1999, he graduated from Northeastern University under the advisement of Dr. Elaine Parma. He eventually went on to become the director of electrophysiology research at the Heart Institute at Beth Israel. He then was a research associate at the Veterinary School of Biomedical Sciences at Cornell University. He joined the physics department faculty here at Georgia Tech in 2012 as an associate professor. And since then, he's been getting many awards for his teaching through the CETL Institute, for CETL, which is the Center for the Enrichment of Teaching and Learning. And he is also a GoSTEM fellow. So with that, I would like to
thank you.
Give it over to Dr. Fenton.
Thanks, Andrea. Thank you. It's a very nice introduction. She's one of my students, so I guess she had to do put good stuff. Well, thank you so much for coming this morning. So it's a pleasure to be here talking with you guys. I've been here a few times. It's kind of early in the morning, so I have missed a few, but I've been in a few of these already. They're really a lot of fun. I like them. So again, anytime you have a questions, please interrupt me, and we can keep it casual. So today I'll talk a little bit about the heart, chaos in the heart, or actually how to fix what sublime donors are going to do to us. So it was perfect, actually, it was perfect. Perfect for food for today, I guess. What I want to, the outline of my talk is I'll talk about oscillations in complex systems in general, then how these oscillations actually can produce spiral waves, then how they're rated in the heart, and then some instabilities that produce these spiral waves in the heart, and then I talk at the end about some methods that we have used of nonlinear dynamics to try to terminate arrhythmias using low energy. So some applications of all the theory that we have developed through the years, an application really into the clinics. So when we talk about complex systems, in my lab we work with things that oscillate, anything that oscillates I like. And when you say complex system, doesn't need to be very complicated. Very simple systems can have very complex dynamics. So a very simple example that we're working in the lab with one of my undergrads, Mel, and one of my postdocs, Greg. If you take a candle and you put a stick through the center of the candle, you can balance the candle, and it can be basically, if you do it really in the center of mass, then you can balance it, it will be static. Then you can burn it from both ends. So if you start burning the candle from both ends, it's going to start dripping wax. So it's never going to be exactly symmetric. One is going to drip a little bit more wax than the other one, so it's going to tilt. And as it tilts, then the flame is always going to be perpendicular because of gravity. So as it tilts, the lower end is going to have touching more the flame, the lower one is going to touch more wax than the one on the higher one. So the lower one is going to lose more weight than the higher one. So then it's going to change center of mass, and it's going to oscillate. And as it changes here, then it's going to keep oscillating. So let me show you the movie. So it's a simple, and this is actually a very nice simple toy that it was devised in last century in France. So there are a couple of examples on how they use it. They didn't have TV, so it was one of the nice things to play with at night. So you can see how the oscillation starts and goes very complicated. It can oscillate very, very wide. Now, from nonlinear dynamics, we know that any system that has three or more degrees of freedom can actually have chaos. So in these cases, this is kind of like similar to a pendulum. It has theta and theta dot, so those are two degrees of freedom. But the other one is the center of mass that is changing. So the center of mass gives you three degrees of freedom that can, in principle, give you chaos. However, when we were doing the simulation, it was not producing chaos. It can produce really a lot of oscillations, but it didn't produce chaos. So one of the things that we tried to do is we figure out that there was a little bit of damping. There was some friction on the post that produced damping. So we took out the friction. We put some barbells into the system. So my undergrad, she designed a much more professional device where you can put a 3D printer so you can have a section where we can put them on a barbell with no friction. And in that case, now it becomes chaotic. It can rotate, and it actually can go all around one time. So here it's going to go almost all around. And it seems it's going to stop, but it actually is going to flip. So it flips, and then it can come back again. And it becomes chaotic. Now it has a complex dynamic. So you see that you follow the trajectory of this tip as function of time. it just becomes complicated. It's just a chaotic system. So now it shows that it's a very simple system that oscillates but can have chaotic dynamics. And chaotic dynamics simply means that if you have two, if you start the system with just a small initial condition difference, the dynamics in space is going to be, in time and space is going to change eventually. So this is the trajectory of two points at the same time that we started it in phase space, but as function of time, they start diverging. And that's basically what is chaotic, that just the small initial conditions, changes in initial conditions will have eventually different dynamics in time and space. So these oscillations, when we put it in space, they can produce waves. So waves kind of like the waves that we see in the stadiums when they have the wave. You can have these waves that propagate. Now, when these waves, so any oscillation that you couple in space can produce a wave. Now, sometimes when you break the symmetry of the propagation of these waves, they can produce spiral waves. And spiral waves, they form in many, many systems. So what happens is you have a wave front that propagates following a wave back. And when you break it, then the front and the back, they have to meet at some point. And the front, I don't have a, okay. So the front and the back, they're following. When they break, they have to, the front has a velocity going in this direction, the back is this direction. When you break it, the front is going this way, the back is going this way. There's a point where they meet, where there's going to be a change in phase. The normal velocity is going to be zero, right? Because these velocities are like that. And at some point, there's going to be zero normal velocity. So that waves the initial, the point, the pivot point for a spiral wave to rotate. So this is one of the reasons how many of these systems that have oscillations can produce spiral waves. So let me just show you an example that we did here at Georgia Tech. So many of you, were part of it. We have done it 2 years in a row. We tried to do it another year. We have done this one with Andrea. She's the one she's been working with me on this thing. So the idea is to put, so we could collect about 600 students. We put them in a grid. We give an initial condition. Let me stop it for a sec. So we need an initial condition here of a wave, kind of similar like the wave in the stadium. But in a wave of a stadium, you have a wave that propagates and just finishes, and that's it. Here, we started with an initial condition that the wave that's only started this section here, it will excite on one side, but the first time will not excite on the opposite side. So it will propagate in this direction. So now you have the wave and the wave back. And as I'm saying, because it was broken here, it will pivot and it will start the spiral wave. So let me show it again. Let me show it. So here's the wave, and it starts rotating. So it produces a very nice spiral wave. Once the spiral wave is formed, it's basically just stable and will continue rotating as long as the system keeps producing oscillations. Now, one of the things that happens when it touches the boundary, here it touches the boundary and it annihilates, and it just ends up the wave. Now, one of the things that happens is that these spiral waves, it takes very little actually to break a spiral wave. This is another experiment that another one of the tries we did here, because not all the students, let me just pause it for a second. The activation, basically the rules was, if you get excited, then if you get excited, if one in your, any of your four neighbors is excited. So basically, if one of your neighbors is get excited, then you're gonna get excited, and that's how the wave propagates. Because not everybody's completely following that rule. Sometimes people see the wave a little bit sooner, so then excite a little sooner. Some are actually just not looking, and then they see the wave coming, and then they excite a little too late. So there's a little bit of coupling. So that's enough sometimes to produce a wave to break. And when it breaks, then produces multiple waves. Let me show you again this. So in this case, there was a spiral wave was rotating here. Then a couple of students suddenly got excited a little too early or too late, and it broke the wave. And it just becomes chaotic. So instead of one spiral wave, you now have a lot of multiple spiral waves through the domain, right? So it just becomes, so it shows you how easy it's actually to destabilize a spiral wave into breakup. And once you have multiple spiral waves, then you have chaos. Because you have fast frequencies, but out of phase. So then the system is completely chaotic. So Sparrowways actually, it can happen to us. Not only we're part of nature, so there are a lot of systems that actually can produce sparrowways. So there are some that are not dangerous. This is erythema nullare. It's an irritation of the skin. It's similar to athlete's foot. When you have athlete's foot, but on other parts of your skin, it's called ringworm. So it's similar to ringworm, but ringworm just propagates and it continues getting excited. Erythema nullare, it irritates, but it heals behind the irritation. So because of that, it can produce spiral waves. So this irritation can, in time, in a couple of days, it keeps propagating and keep producing spiral waves. So this is just irritation of the skin. Another one is geographical tongue. That actually, when you get sick, sometimes your tongue gets a little white and gets the activation. So that actually can produce these waves that if they break, they can produce spiral waves in the tongue. Now those are just spiral waves that happen in the skin on the tissue, but are not dangerous. Now in the heart, actually we can have these waves that actually can form. But before I show you the spiral waves in the heart, let me show you the regular heart. So this is a dog heart. So this is the atria. This is the ventricle. This is producing the contraction. And we always follow the contraction of the heart following the ECG. So the ECG in this heart has a P wave, which is the contraction of the atria. You see the atria is much smaller than the ventricle, so that's why the signal of the P wave is much smaller. Then you have the activation of the ventricle, which is the QRS, which is the activation, and the T wave is the activation of the heart. So when you have this, the ECG, you have then the activation of the atria, which it contracts, but it contracts because it's an electrical signal that propagates through the atria. So that's why you can measure an action potential, and you can measure the sum of the action potentials of the atria gives you this P wave on the QRS, on the ECG. And then you have the QRS is the activation of the ventricles, and T wave is the activation, all right? So in the heart, you can have the normal rhythm will be produced by an activation of the waves propagating through the heart, making the heart contract at once. When these waves break, they can produce spiral waves. Now, every time you perturb one wave and produce a spiral wave, it will produce a frequency that is faster than the natural pacemaker. These spiral waves, when they form in the heart, they rotate with a frequency that is faster than the natural SA node. So they take control over the heart and they make it contract faster. And then the signal that you get on the ECG will be a much faster signal. Just the rotation. Now, as I show you with the students, very often a spiral wave destabilizes. Now, there are many mechanisms that destabilize spiral waves. I'll show you a couple on during the talk. So one is the coupling. Decoupling can destabilize the waves and can produce multiple spiral waves that produces the chaos, the chaotic dynamic. So this one, when you measure in the ECG, is just basically very complicated, just very small signal because it's just all activation. And in this case, the heart cannot contract anymore, cannot pump blood, and that's what produces sudden cardiac death. All right. Any questions so far? Okay. So let me show you an example. Here's a heart that is in ventricular tachycardia. So the heart is contracting very fast, and it's contracting very fast because we have a spiral wave actually driving the heart. So if you show you a simulation of what's happening here. So you have what's happening here with the heart is rotating very, is contracting very fast because it's driven by a spiral wave that is driving this fast contraction, right? So that's just for the now, as I say, very often they destabilize and then they break, and then they produce. So now this is a heart after tachycardia went into fibrillation. So now you see it's just shivering. It's not contracting anymore because it has a bunch of little spiral waves driving through the heart. Let me show you the numerical simulation for this. So now you have multiple spiral waves driving the heart to this more irregular rhythm, right? and the same. So you have the atria and you have the ventricles. So you can, the same way you can have fibrillation in the ventricles, you have fibrillation in the atria. So now here the atria are the ones with the spiral waves. Now the activation goes from the atria to the ventricle through the AV node. So when you have fibrillation in the atria, you have the atria is just shivering. But then activation goes to the ventricle, but goes very regularly through the SA node. The AV node is a filter. So not all the activations going to the AV node go through the ventricle, just every other. So now the activation of the ventricle is still contracts, but it's not very regularly. So when you have spiral waves in the ventricles, it's deadly almost instantaneously. You have to get rid of them within seconds or within minutes. If it happens in the atria, you can live. You can have a life. You're always tired. You don't feel well, and it's a major cause for strokes. So this is not deadly right away, but of course it will be deadly in time. But if it happens in the ventricles, then that's when we have to do a big electric shock, which I'll show you by the end of the talk. So heart disease is one of the leading causes of death in industrialized world. That's the reason, one of the reasons we study them. It ranks number one in industrialized countries. About one third of all the total deaths in the United States are due to heart disease. This is the same amount of the next two causes of heart disease, of death, which is cancer and brain problems. So let me just talk quickly a little bit about the how is this electrical signal happening in the heart. So the heart contracts, as I say, because there's an electrical wave that propagates. So this electrical signal that we see is a change in voltage. Actually, here is normalized. But in general, the cardiac cells the heart is constructed of cardiac cells, which are about 100 microns in length. They are like more like rods. They're 100 microns in length by 10 microns in radius. They produce what is called an action potential. The voltage change, it goes from minus 35 millivolts to about 20 millivolts. This change in voltage produced by a change in voltage between the inside and the outside of the cells. So the cells, they follow, they have this membrane that separates the concentrations of ions between inside and outside the cell. This membrane has some proteins that go across the membrane. These proteins, they open and close as function of voltage and as function of time. So this is where the nonlinear dynamics of the problem comes from, and what we do, we use mathematical models to try to understand the dynamics of the cells. So the opening and closing of these channels, there are different types of channels depending on the ions. So there are ion channels for sodium, for potassium, for calcium. There are also some sodium-calcium exchangers, potassium-sodium exchangers as well. So for each one of these, you have to write a differential equation that solves the dynamics of the ions going through them. In reality, it's just mostly it's Ohm's law. It gives you the current that goes through is proportional to the voltage given a conductance. Now the problem is that this conductance is just basically how much ions can be allowed to pass through the ion channels, because these ion channels open and close. And they are non-linearly. They open and close as function of voltage, but as function of time. The amount of current, this G, is variable. And this G actually has to be written by a differential equation that explains the dynamics of this opening and close. So that's where the complication comes from. For these channels, you have a form like this, but you have to have a very complicated equation for G that solves this time dependence. So, and then you have to do it for all the ion channels that you have around the membrane. So that's why simulations of cardiac dynamics can become very complicated, because you have a lot of equations just for one cell. You have to account for a lot of different currents that happen in the cell. So you can have models. Sometimes as physicists and mathematicians, we try to construct simple models. So a four-variable model is enough to reproduce more of the basic dynamics. But if you want to go into detail with all the different parameters that you have of all the ion channels, there are models that have up to 100 equations for one cell. So now you have 100 equations that you have to solve with a lot of different parameters for one cell. And if you go to scale, then it has become very complicated to solve. So as I was saying, the electrical signal actually produces the contraction. The contraction is produced because as the voltage changes in the membrane, Calcium inside the cell gets released. Calcium then binds between the myosin and the actin and produces the contraction. So this contraction is produced first by an electrical signal that releases calcium and then produces the contraction. As physicists, the nice thing about the heart is that we can study it in different levels. We can have, we can study like single cell will be like a zero order dynamics. So it's just dynamics of voltage in time because it's only single cell. We can go inside the heart when you open a ventricle. The activation from the atria to the ventricle goes very quickly through a path called the Purkinje fibers. So you can see here, this is the AV node. This is a path, we stain the, this ad hoc heart stain with Lugos, so you can see actually the staining of these Purkinje fibers. So the idea is the activation comes from the atria to the ventricle. You want to activate the ventricle very quickly. So this propagation along the fibers is actually 300 centimeters per second. So activation goes very quickly into the ventricles, so the ventricles can interact, contract very quickly. So these Purkinje fibers, sometimes they go across the tissue. So you can actually cut them and have basically two islands of tissue connected by a Purkinje fiber. So it's a very nice system to study one-dimensional dynamics. So you can have a very one, so we can study single cell, a 0D. We can study a one-dimensional cable. We can take the atria. The atria can be actually very thin. There are some sections where the atria can be so thin that it's only a few cells in thickness. You can see translucency through the atria. So that accounts for simulations of experiments that we can do in quasi 2D. And of course, in 3D, the structure of the heart is more complicated, right? The other thing that is very nice about the heart is the scaling. So we can hold, there are different sizes of animals, so different sizes of hearts. This is a mouse heart, which is about a neonatal mouse heart, which is about half a centimeter. This is a mouse heart, which is about 1 centimeter. And this is a horse heart. So horse heart, they're made for running. So when you open a horse, basically it's just lungs and heart. It's just, so the heart's about this size. So the different scales that you have, but also you can have, the nice thing about the heart is a very robust machine. Once you take it out of an animal, you can actually keep it alive. You can perfuse the, so this is a rabbit heart being perfused and being kept alive. So now you see the atria contracting and the ventricle contracting. This is zebrafish hearts. So zebrafish hearts are about 1/4 millimeter. And this is one of the horse hearts that I did when I was in Cornell. So this is just the atria. So we just take out the atria. The atria is this size. So we can keep it perfused. We close, and you can keep it alive. So the nice thing is that then. You can do nice experiments, you can do numerical simulations, but you can do also experiments directly on heart, so you can actually try to understand the dynamics from both point of views, from numerical simulations to the experiments. So numerical simulations, we try to do the simulations, as I say, first solving the ionic channels, the equations for the ionic channels for one cell, and then we have to connect it in tissue. So they connect basically as a resistors. So you have every cell will have their own dynamics and then connected by gap junctions, which are basically like resistors. And you can have extracellular medium and intracellular medium. And then the membrane conductance in between. So basically what you have to do is write all these differential equations for the currents, all these Ohm's law equations for one cell and then coupled through all the other cells. And they coupled by diffusion. So it's actually, to write the equations of the voltage propagation in the heart is actually very simple to write. It just basically says the change of voltage in time is going to be the sum of the ion channels that exist in the cell plus a diffusion term, a coupling. Now, the problem is it's very easy to write. Now, in reality, this ion channel is the sum of all these ions for each one of the cells. And then this diffusion term here is actually a three-dimensional structure that gives you the information of the heart and the fibers along the heart. Because I was saying the cells are elongated, right? We showed that it was about 100 microns by 10 microns. So propagation along the fibers is 3 times faster than across the fibers. On the Purkinje fibers, I was telling you, Purkinje fibers, the propagation speed is about 300 centimeters per second. In normal cardiac tissue, normal cells, is about 80 centimeters per second. So it's 80 centimeters per second along the fibers, but across the fibers, is about 30 centimeters per second. So it's an order of 3 to 1. So that effect, and then fibers, as they go from the ventricle, they rotate. The fibers, as these fiber sheets, as you go from the inside to the outside of the heart, they rotate 180 degrees. So there's an anisotropy that you have to account when you solve these differential equations that comes into these diffusion terms on here. So anyway, so it's just easy to write, but it's a little more complicated than to solve it. That's just my point that I want to say. But then once you do it, simulations, you can do simulations of propagation of a wave. So you can stimulate a tissue. When you stimulate a piece of tissue, why is it going away? Anyway, so you can stimulate and you have a wave that propagates through the tissue. Okay, this starts again. As I was saying, so the structure you have to account for this diffusion in the structure of this diffusion tensor accounts for is a value of 10 to 1, which equivalents to the 1 to because the diffusion goes as the velocity goes as the square root of the diffusion. That's why a 10 to 1 gives you a change between of 1 to 3. So different, we have obtained different structures. We can do simulations in different types of structures. We have porcine, rabbit, canine. We can always get the heart at the end of the experiments. We can try to bring it to a micro CT or an MRI to get the structure and to get information of the fibers. As I was mentioning, as you go from the epicardium to the endocardium, there's a 180 degree rotation of the fibers. It's because the fibers, they follow geodesics. And these geodesics, they form little cones as you go into the ventricle. So that's why you go from the inside to the outside, you see this rotation. And the idea is that when you want to do it, it's very nice. There's a very nice paper from a mathematician in the Courant Institute, which he derived this structure just from first principles. And the idea is that if you want to have a very strong pump, that when it contracts, it pushes good, you not only want to squeeze, but you want to squeeze and twist. So you get by the twisting, you get more and more strength by more force by the amount of contraction. So that's just function to make it much better contraction. But then simulations, of course, get more complicated because you have to account for this anisotropy. There's also some other stuff that I want to talk to you when you want to include contraction. But for now, we're just going to consider only the electrical signal. When studying cardiac dynamics, there are two different types of groups: people who just concentrate on the electrical signal and people who concentrate on the contraction. Both are important, but then we divide it into electricians and plumbers, and then I'm more an electrician, so I work more on the electrical side, driving the arrhythmias. But there are people here in the department who also work on contraction and fluid dynamics. So anyway, for the modeling of the electrical signal, as I was saying, you can do different models. You can have models with ODEs between 4 to 100 for each cell. So using equations for the ion channels between 4, which is the minimal amount to produce a similar action potential to what you see experimentally, to more realistic models that account for 100 variables. To solve these differential equations, you have to use a discretization in time of 0.01 milliseconds. Because they are very sharp. The upstroke of the action potential is very, very, it happens in about 5 milliseconds. So the voltage in the signal on the cell, it gets activated within 5 milliseconds. It goes from -85 to 20 millivolts in 5 milliseconds. So it's very sharp. And then it lasts about 200 milliseconds before it comes back to rest. So that's why numerically you have to account for that using 0.01 milliseconds. The number of cells simulated, if you have to account for the discretization in space. So that means about 200 microns for any time step when you do a simulation. So that requires that if you're doing a simulation of a 4 by 4 centimeters tissue, you require 200 by 200 elements of the microns times 4 times, so that's give you 1,160,000 ODE equations for four variables. If you have 100 variables, you require 4 million ODEs every time step. If you use a model that is a little bit more complicated, something in between the two, 29 variables, this is a dog model on Rudy. 1 second of simulation in 2D would require basically 10 to the 11 differential equations. If you want to do 1 second of simulation in 3D, then require 20 trillion ODEs to be solved. So this is actually an amount of large enough that you have to use supercomputers. So people over the last few decades, we have been using supercomputers to run these problems. The nice thing about these problems is that they, because of the equation, the form of the equations that we have, the diffusion, they linearize very nicely. So the more processors you use, basically, just if you use 2 processors, you speed it up by 2. If you use 4 processors, you speed it up by 4. So it's almost linear. The more processors you got, the faster you get the solution, and it's almost linear, which is very nice for these kind of problems. Now, one of the nice things is that over the last few years, not only supercomputers are available, but also, how many of you have heard about GPUs? So GPUs is now, is the same, is graphic cards. In the computer, we always run everything in the CPU. But now, there's the graphic card, which displays, has a lot of little processors that can be used to compute. They have many more, they're less powerful, but they have a lot. So if you use these graphic cards to solve, now it's very cheap nowadays, and you can actually parallelize very quickly and solve these systems much faster. So we're using GPUs. Now actually these models, you can actually even solve them into your cell phone. So the cell phone, it has a graphic card because of course it displays. So you can recruit the graphic cards to produce simulations for this model. So let me show you here. This is my cell phone running, it is running in the cell phone. This is a simple model with a spiral wave that produces that we activate and it can produce. Now, and you can do a simulation here in 3D as well. So that's one of the nice things about now. We're reaching the time that we can actually do simulations on the 3D heart, of course, in a desktop computer, but also imagine if you can do it on a cell phone, how much faster you can do on things on a computer. All right. So that's just right now for the modeling. I'll come back a little bit more modeling, but let me show you. Once we do the modeling, we have to compare with experiments. So how do we can verify and understand the dynamics that we see experimentally with the numerical part or vice versa? So we need to visualize this electrical signal in the heart. So over the last 20 years, people have developed what is called optical mapping. So in the lab, we work with optical mapping with my postdoc Ilya Selak and Connor. He's also working in the lab doing some of the experiments. So the idea is that you can, once you have the heart perfused and you keep it alive, you can stain the membrane with certain dyes that get into the membrane, and then they fluoresce as function of the voltage. So what happens is that they absorb light at one frequency and then they emit at a different frequency, and the emission can change a little bit as function of the voltage. So the structure can change a little bit as function of the voltage, such that the emission of the photons that emit can change a little bit the frequency as function of the voltage. So this fluorescence, so they get excited one frequency, they have an excitation, an absorption frequency, and they have an emission frequency, right? So they absorb this light and then emit this light. And now, but the trick is that the emission peak is as function of the voltage. So if the voltage is minus 85 millivolts, the peak is here. If the voltage is 20 millivolts, the peak is here. So it shifts the peak. Now, the peak, that shift is very small. It's a few nanometers. So here I'm just showing it big, but it's only a few nanometers, such that this shift here is almost linear. It's almost an amount of linear. So the nice thing is that then, So this emission changes as function of the voltage, but the nice thing is that you can excite the tissue with a light absorption spectra, which in this case for this voltage membrane diaphoreneps, in this case is a drug called diaphoreneps, is around 450. So you excite at around 450, then you can put a filter around 600, so you only visualize light coming above 600. So it is going to shift the voltage, it's going to shift, and as it shifts, the amount of light that you're going to get, the intensity is going to change, and it's going to change linearly to proportional to the voltage. So the idea is to you visualize this, and this change, and this change is going to be linearly proportional to the voltage. So as this voltage shifts, the amount of light that you see increases or decreases. In this case, because it shifts to the left, is inversely proportional. Is linear proportional, but negatively. So you have an action potential, and as it changes, you're going to get, this is the signal that you're going to see optically. So the nice thing is you have a piece of tissue, you can perfuse it, you keep it alive, you perfuse with these drugs, you excite with about 480, in this case, which is in the green. You put the filter for visualizing above 600, which is in the red, and this is what you see. So this is a piece of tissue that gets a stain. And then you can just change you record in time with a high-speed camera, and any small changes in intensities are going to really reflect it to the voltage. So this is an action potential measure in a single cell, and this is the voltage equivalent from an optical mapping. So the signal is a little bit more noisy, but the thing is that this one now, this signal, we can see it especially everywhere because we record from the camera, so we can see everywhere in the tissue on the surface, this signal. So we can put a color. We can put, when the tissue is minus 85 millivolts, we can say it's black. When it's 20 millivolts, we can say it's yellow. So that way, we can actually visualize the signals. We can also do the same thing for calcium. So in the system, we can have one dye for voltage, one dye for calcium, and we can switch the lights, and we can switch then, and we can visualize both signals at the same time with one camera. So let me show you the example now. This is a right ventricle and right ventricle, right atria. So now this is the activation coming from the SA node. This is actually what we can visualize. So you see the electrical signal going through the atria. And same way, this is a ventricle. This is the electrical we're passing from here. So you see this electrical signal now passing through the ventricle. So that way we can actually visualize the spiral waves. So this is a spiral wave, this is a pig heart, and this is a spiral wave following going around the ventricle. And then after a few seconds, as I say, they're very unstable, they break, and now it becomes chaotic. And you have all the spiral waves. All right? So one of the things we're trying to study is that the dynamics, what produces a spiral wave, go from a stable spiral wave to chaos, to multiple waves. So we saw at the beginning of the talk, one case was coupling. Decoupling can actually affect a little bit the propagation of the waves, can destabilize. There are other mechanisms. Let me show you quickly one example of that. Before that, let me show you exactly how spiral waves can form. It's all about timing. When you excite a cardiac cell, you produce an action potential. And before you can produce another excitation, the system has to go back to rest, it needs some time to recover. So if you stimulate an action potential and you try to stimulate again, there's not enough, the channels have not opened again, they are still remain closed, they're refractory, so then there's no activation, right? If you wait long enough, then the cells open again and then you can have another action potential. So what happens is that if you have a stimulus coming, and then I stimulate in the back, and the cells have recovered, then I have another activation, right? So this is an action potential propagation. I stimulate, and then I stimulate, it propagates. Now, if I stimulate too soon on the back of a wave, when the tissue is refractory, then it will die out. So I stimulate and dies out, because it was too soon behind the wave. Right? So if I'm very soon behind the wave, it will die out because it's refractory. If I'm back a little farther away, then it activates. Right? So in between, there's a window of vulnerability in between. Part of the tissue can be excitable, but part of the tissue will be refractory. So that means that if I stimulate at that point, part of the wave propagates in one direction, but it gets blocked on the other direction. And that's what produces the so now in this case, it was propagating in one direction, but blocked on the other one direction, so that initiates the spiral wave. So let me show you again. We stimulate here. It was propagating in one direction, but blocks on the other direction. Right? So this is one of the mechanisms to initiate the spiral waves, by conduction block. Once you have a spiral wave, we always think of a spiral wave following like a circular trajectory, right? Kind of like an archimedial spiral wave. But it turns out that the dynamics of the spiral wave, this rotation, it depends on the excitability of the system and the wavelength of the duration of the activation. So by changing parameters in a model, in a cell model, we can go from a circular core to a epicycloidal trajectory. So with the what is called inner petals, to a cycloidal trajectory, which completely is just cycloidal, to the epicycloidal, now with the patterns outside. You can go to more higher order frequencies when you have hypermeander, so the dynamics of the spiral wave will be more complicated. And all the way up to what is called linear trajectory, where the wavelength is so fast that it is so large that it blocks itself until finally has enough time to activate again and turns around. So all these dynamics, as you go from circular core to linear core, it depends on the excitability of the system. The higher the excitability, the more the linear core trajectory. The lower the excitability, in this case. Excitability is related to, in principle, in heart with oxygen. So if you have a heart that is ischemic, that is losing oxygen, you're going to get these kind of spiral waves. If the heart is excitable, is high with oxygen, it's going to start with these spiral waves. So at the beginning, when you have a spiral wave forming, the heart will start this form, and with time, it will develop into those ones. And also, this during this trajectory, there are also other things that can happen that can destabilize spiral waves and make them break. So let me show you an example of a circular core in an experiment, and also of a linear core in an experiment. So this is just following the linear core trajectory. So one of the examples I'll show you quickly is that we can use mathematics to explain these instabilities of spiral waves is what is called alternance. So alternance is a period doubling bifurcation. Let me explain to you quickly what it is. As I was saying, you have an action potential. When you excite a cell, you have an action potential. If you wait long enough, you excite again, you have another action potential similar to the first one, if you wait long enough. We call, in cardiology, they call the time between activations, they call it DI for diastolic interval. The time, the duration of the excitation, they call action potential duration of APD. So if you stimulate sooner, you make the diastolic interval smaller, the APD will start becoming a little smaller because the cell has no time to recover, right? So you start pacing faster and faster, the action potential becomes smaller and smaller and smaller until you finally reach a small diastolic interval when there's no activation, right? The refractory period. So you can create a curve of that diastolic interval that gives you the APD as function of the diastolic interval, right? At large diastolic intervals, you get action potentials that are basically the same, right? As you decrease the diastolic interval, the action potential becomes smaller and smaller until you finally reach a point that there's no activation. So this curve is just a response function that tells you how the heart reacts as function of pacing. And this curve is very, very, very important for the dynamics because you can do what is called a map. So I won't bore you quickly with the dynamics, but you can create a one-dimensional map, a function. You can do some analysis there, some what is called linear stability analysis, and it will tell you that any perturbation will grow as function of what is called as function of the derivative of this curve. The only thing that works up, I won't bore you with the math, but basically what happens is that if the curve, this curve, has a slope greater than one, so as it changes, if it has very, very steep, it becomes very steep, then if you pace at large at cycle lengths where this curve is steep, it's going to produce a bifurcation. And let me show you how that's actually. So let me just show you the example here. How do I move to this page? Okay, here. So here, this is the curve. This is the restitution curve. Pacing at 45 degrees, pacing at constant cycle lengths are lined at 45 degrees. So so numerically, what I was just showing you is calculating this stability of this point. As I change the period, I get a fixed point. Right? It gives me a one-to-one solution. But once you go this part here where the slope is greater than one, what's going to happen is that there's going to produce a bifurcation. And this is very nice because it just comes from the pure mathematics of the system. It just tells you that if you have this kind of function then it's going to, if you do an activation, you produce a return map, it's going to alternate between two points. So it has it has a solution of one-to-one, but at some point when you pace at a constant cycling, you're not going to have a one-to-one response. You're going to have a long response and a short response. So the action potential is going to be long, short, long, short. So that's actually very cool, right? Because now you have this, you start pacing a tissue. When you start pacing very fast, it will develop suddenly this period doubling bifurcation. And this is an experiment. So this is, we're pacing faster. The pacing cycle length is constant. So you see the activation is paced at a constant cycle length. But now the response is a long action potential, a short action potential, long action potential. So it produces this activation. And that actually eventually will produce fibrillation. And the reason is because, comes a little bit more to, you have this period doubling bifurcation. You go from 2 to 2. Then it goes to 4 to 4. Then it goes to 8 to 8, 16 to 16, until you go to chaos. So this is some of the experimental data that we can measure of this transition. I won't have time to show you quickly, but basically what happens is that numerically, I won't show you, but I'll show you experimentally. When you have this alternance in duration, imagine it's a wave that propagates. And as it propagates, the long wave, and the next time it's a short wave. And a long wave and a short wave. Now, as it propagates, conduction velocity changes too. And that actually what does is that the long wave as it propagates is going to become short, and the short one as it propagates becomes long. And that actually produces these waves to oscillate as they propagate. And that can produce dispersion of refractoriness in the tissue that can produce fibrillation. So let me show you this example of this movie. Coming in this, the others. Let me move it from this. Okay, here it is. Okay, let me pause it for a second. So this is a rabbit heart. It's spaced at different cycle lengths. This is 350 milliseconds, 200, 180, 170, 160, 150, 146. At this cycle length, there's no alternance. The wave propagates nicely. So everywhere propagates, and this is voltage and this is calcium. So the voltage propagates, so we're stimulating from somewhere here. So the wave propagates through the ventricle, and you'll see that propagates very nicely on every beat. But as your cycle length increases, now, as I showed you, these waves get long, short as they propagate. So the duration of the activation becomes very complicated and much different. So let me show the movie. So here first, let's look at this one. It's just a wave that propagates, and then the next one follows, and it's not too complicated. But as you go farther and faster, now the propagation is not the same, right? It just gets long and short, and it's not continuously going in a very nice trajectory, right? Let me show you again. So here, it blocks, and then it blocks here, and it propagates back this fire. And then the next time is the inverse, right? So when it was short, it's going to be long. And when it was long, it's going to be short. So you see the wave is propagating now not homogeneously, right? It's starting to become around like wandering. And that's what produces this initiation of arrhythmias. So as you pace faster and faster, you produce this alternating of the waves that with conduction velocity, they change through space, and then that produces these heterogeneous waves of propagation and eventually can block and produce fibrillation. So for example here, this is a spiral wave that is doing the oscillation of the waves I was telling you. So it gets long, short. At some point, it gets too long, too short that the next wave actually collides, and it starts producing breakup. So this is one of the mechanisms that can produce this stability, and it's very nice that you can first prove it mathematically where it comes from. You can do the simulations, and then you can do it experimentally, and you can see this transition actually occurring. Another thing is that it makes life more complicated too, is that all the spiral waves I was showing you just in 2D. When you go to 3D, spiral waves, they have actually a three-dimensional information. So there's topology involved in 3D. So when you visualize spiral waves in 2D, you can put a color to the voltage. In 3D, it's a little harder because you have X, Y, and Z, and you cannot put a collage for the voltage. So to visualize a spiral wave in 3D, what we do is we look for the point with zero normal velocity. That's the phase, the singularity on the spiral wave, the tip of the spiral wave. So the tip of the spiral wave in 3D becomes a vortex filament. So if you have a cube, and if I go through the cube, through the different levels of the cube, I can see the spiral wave as it follows. So I can follow the trajectory of the tip in space, and that's going to form a vortex filament. And by following this vortex filament, I can if I know the torsion, the twist, and the curvature at every time, I know where the spiral wave is at every time. So it becomes complicated because now you have topological effects. Now you can have a spiral wave that forms inside, like a ring, and then disappears. You can have one that appears and can fuse, or one vice versa that can expand and can pinch. So now dynamics of scroll waves in 3D becomes more complicated. So this is a simulation of a. So this is a front view, a back view of a rabbit ventricle, the view from the apex, and this is a transmural view where you have the vortex filaments driving the fibrillation. So now you have effects that is the not only the rotation of the fibers, the coupling of the cells, but also the three-dimensionality of the vortex filaments that makes life very complicated for these arrhythmias to terminate. And that's why they're very easy to initiate. All right, so how we can terminate this arrhythmia? So I'll just finish quickly with an example of termination. To terminate arrhythmias, you have to do a big electric shock. And this electric shock, basically you have a spiral wave, you have the spiral waves here. The only way you can terminate them is by applying an electric shock that's strong enough that excites everywhere, and then basically then kills all the waves, right? So what you want to do is a strong electric field that excites all the cells and kills the waves. So here's going to be an example again. We excite now, but it's long enough that everybody finally gets excited and it just dies out, and then the heart can go back to normal. In order to do that, you have to apply at least 5 volts per centimeter inside the heart. And to do that, if you're external shock, you have to do between 100 joules to 360 joules. That's a lot. That's 1,000 volts, 30 amperes, for about 2 milliseconds. But that's a lot of current. It's very strong. I didn't brought today, but another thing I have time. But it takes only 0.001 joules to make your heart, to make your arm move. If I apply a current that has 0.01 milliamperes, I can make your arm move. So imagine 360 joules is actually very painful. If it's internal, it can lower to 7 joules, but it still is very painful. And it's not only painful, but it actually can damage also the it can burn some of the tissue in the ventricles. So what we're going to do, what we design is instead of doing one big shock, we can do multiple shocks, try to synchronize the system to terminate it to a new frequency. So I don't have time to show you this part here, but it's just all the theory behind that. But let me show you an example where we actually, this is an arrhythmia in an atria where we shock with one, so we do one big shock, and it terminates the arrhythmia, right? So now the big shock is strong enough that eventually everybody gets excited. So this is amount of tissue excited as function of time. So it's oscillating to the arrhythmia. You shock, and eventually everybody gets excited, so then you can terminate the arrhythmia. Now in this case, we're going to do 5 multiple shocks, each one with very low energy. But little by little, what we're doing is synchronizing the system to the new frequency until everybody gets excited, and then you terminate. If you take the derivative of this signal, it's basically the synchronization. So it's telling you that every time you shock, you start synchronizing more and more tissue to the new frequency. Until everybody responds to that frequency, you stop pacing, and then the tissue goes back to normal. So that requires only 10% of the energy compared to the one shock. So that's actually very, very nice, because then we can try it in vivo. So we try that in vivo in dog atria. So we can have this with catheters inside the atria, one in each right and left atria, where we can produce an electric field. So this is an example of, so this is the right ventricle, this is the right atria. So this dog is in AF. It's in AF. We're going to do one big shock to terminate the arrhythmia. And it goes back to normal. Right? But the shock was enough to terminate the arrhythmia, but it's strong enough that actually engage all the nervous system, and then makes the animal move, right, and jump. And that's why it's very painful, because it's a strong enough electric field that recruits all the nerves and makes the muscles contract. Now, let me show you the same thing, but now using five pulses, using the same... is not going to show. It never happened to me this before. Maybe we play it again. Okay, here it goes. So now it's going to be five pulses, 10% the energy, recovers the normal activation. And now it was low enough that it didn't recruit the nervous system, so it was not painful. Right? So let me just show you one more. So it's in AF. We do the five pulses. So we show this one actually in both optical mapping and in vitro, and we can get the same frequencies, and we can show from the optical mapping that it's actually what we're doing here is actually synchronizing the system, and that's basically what we wanted to show. We did all this one with initial conditions with numerical simulations first, the theory, and then the experiments, and then we managed to succeed on these things. So my point here, what I want to show is that there's a lot of theory behind it, a lot of numerical simulations we can do, and eventually we can actually apply it to medicine, and this is we're working now to try to do the same thing for the ventricles. But so in the meantime, I just want to thank you guys for attending. Some of my collaborators, Elizabeth, Ilya, and Abusar, some of my postdocs, a lot of my students, Andrea, and many of my students, and Connor, and thank you. The NSF has been very kind to us over the years. So thanks, and open for questions. No, not yet. We have a patent for it, but it's very complicated to work with the industry, because they don't care about lowering the energy. They have other concerns right now. For them, the system works, so they are fine. They have other problems like the leads where they connect and problems like that. So those are some of the things that they're concerned. The lowering the energy is good for the patient, but it's not the critical importance from them right now. So it's not, and still, we have a proof of concept that we have done it, but still it has to work for larger animals. It has to, I'll show it for the atria, but there's some problems when you try to do it for the ventricle that you didn't talk. And sometimes if you do multiple shocks, in reality, when you do it in the atria, if you hit what is the T wave during the ECG, you can actually initiate an arrhythmia in the ventricles. So it's not completely safe to do this. Actually, has to become 100% safe. So there are a lot of things that needs to be actually improved in order to have this applicable. Yeah, but at least we have a proof of concept and we can work with it. But yeah, still it's a long way to have it into the clinic. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Thank you. What kind of disease model was this, like pacing-induced atrial fibrillation?
So this one was we stimulate the vagal tone, the vagal nerve, so we can keep it. It was healthy animal, but just induced by stimulation of the vagal node, we can induce ACH, and then that stable fibrillation on the atria.
Do you plan on testing testing ventricular disease model?
Yeah, so we're working actually trying to work with T3 labs to do some ligation on ligations on dog hearts and try to do heart failure.
Maybe one more question? Okay. Well, let's thank our speaker.
Thank you.